You're the God of this city. You're the King of these people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. For greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. You're the God of this city. You're the King of this people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like I.
Welcome to the Grand Bahama District Missions Conference. It's the first Grand Bahama Missions Conference, and we are so happy that you've all joined us. We have our leaders in the Grand Bahama District. We have our Assistant Superintendent, Reverend Lockhart, Robert Lockhart. We have our Presbyter, Reverend Eddie Victor. And we have our esteemed pastors from the five churches of the Assemblies of God in the Bahamas, on Grand Bahama Island, Calvary Temple, Eternal Light, Abundant Life, West Side and Living Water Assembly. We thank God for all of our members and followers, all of you who've joined us this evening. We are here because Jesus Christ himself has said that while he goes to the Father, he has left each and every one of us to do greater works. Wasn't it beautiful to see the great works that the people of God have done over the years, and even in some of our lowest and darkest periods, the people of God rose up and was there to meet the crisis, to help those who are in need in every form and in every fashion. So we give God the glory for the greater works, and that we are here and obedient, ready to go and do these greater works. Tonight, we're going to welcome our missions director, our district missions director, Minister Michelle Britton. Are you there? And are you ready, Minister Michelle Britton?
I am here and I am ready.
Amen.
Good evening, everyone. We just want to welcome you to the Grand Bahama District Missions Conference themed Greater Works. We're so excited to have you here tonight. And on behalf of our district officers, our Presbyter, Reverend Dr. Eddie Victor, our Secretary, Reverend Dr. Margo Victor, our Treasurer, Minister Dudley Francis, we want to extend a warm and hearty welcome, first of all, to our special guests, our missionary pastor, Ashton Brown. We have Reverend Scott Warren with us. We have our own Reverend Jonathan Carey, and we're so excited to hear what they will share with us. And of course, Dr. Victor will be sharing as well. We want to welcome and thank all of those who will be serving on the program in any capacity. We want to extend a special and warm welcome to all of our pastors, all of our leaders, our ministers, the district churches, our friends, supporters, our members, followers, and we just want to extend a warm welcome to you. And we honor your presence with us tonight. Those who joined us from home and abroad, welcome. We want you to stay connected from start to finish because this is going to be exciting. The Lord is preparing his people to reap this end time harvest, and we're excited. And so we just want you to feel welcome. And I also have the duty of giving you a brief report. So I want to transition into that right now. We want to give God glory and honor for all that he has enabled us to do through the Grand Bahama Missions Ministry from January 2020 to November 27, 2021. From January 25th to February 29th, we conducted door-to-door visitations from March 2020 to early 2020. We went into lockdowns and curfews, of course, due to the global pandemic. As a result, we decided to suspend door-to-door visitations and focus on gospel outreaches every 2 weeks, which started September 25th to December 18, 2020. From January 25th to June 25th, 2021, we transitioned to monthly gospel outreaches in partnership with the district Sunday school and district youth department. We had 11 gospel outreaches, 3 Saturday school outreaches, and 2 stoplight outreaches. From these outreaches, 95 souls got saved, 80 children, including some young people, and 15 adults were turned over to the local district churches for follow-up and discipleship. During our gospel outreaches, we also partnered with Convoy of Hope under the leadership of Reverend Lockhart and Minister Rochelle to distribute groceries and other supplies. On October 22nd, we conducted a drive-by gospel outreach in the Hunters area, and one young man got saved, whom the Lord used on October 30th to help draw 50 plus young women and men to the Lord. We are now discipling, we're now discipling some of those young people at Lizzie's on the Bay every Tuesday at 7 p.m. On October 29th, we conducted prayer walks in the neighborhoods in our district churches and also distributed gospel tracts. On November 27th, which just passed, we had a Saturday school outreach, and 40 children plus adults were in attendance. And of course, Minister Yvette led everybody in the sinner's prayer. During the month of December, we will conclude our outreaches with a Christmas gospel outreach on December 11th and Stoplight Ministry on December 18th. We thank God for all the support that was given to us so far to accomplish his work. And we need to pray more than ever. Lord of the harvest, send forth laborers. I thank you for your attention. God bless you. Back to you, Dr. Margo.
Thank you so much, Minister Michelle. There you see it. We have a slate of well-seasoned men and women of God. I mean, I think most of them are reverend doctors on this slate of agenda for the evening. And we thank God for all of you being here. Before we go any further, I want to invite each and every one of you to please press that share button if you are online with us right now. And we all are. This is an online conference. Please send five people and invite five people in your church or even more. Invite them to join us. We're talking about the greater works. We're talking about the command that Jesus gives us that we should go out into all the world and preach the gospel. So we need our brothers and sisters in every church, even throughout the nations of the world, to join us tonight in this special conference. So go right ahead and press that share button, send it to at least five persons. Let's fill up this online room right now. Right now, we are going to call Minister Delinda Smith to come and read our scripture. You can begin preparing for that reading by turning to John chapter 14, reading verses 8 through 12. Minister Delinda Smith.
Good night, everyone. I will be reading from John chapter 14, verses 8 through 12. Philip said, "Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us." Jesus answered, "Don't you know me, Philip, even after I have been among you such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and that the Father is in me? The words I say to you are not just my own. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. Or at least believe on the evidence of the miracles themselves. I tell you the truth. Anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do even greater things than these because I am going to the Father." Blessed be the word of God.
Amen. Praise God. That is the word of God. We're going to call Pastor Kermit Mullings to come now and open this conference up in prayer.
Amen. Praise God. Can you hear me? Hello.
Yes, we can hear you, Pastor.
Praise God. Father, we give you the praise, the glory, and the honor. We are so privileged, Father, to be called your children. And we are even more privileged, Father, to be workers together with you. Father, as we come in this conference, in this gathering of greater works, we come with expectation. Father, we come believing because you said you go to the Father, Jesus. And because you go to the Father, the works that you do, we shall do even greater works. And Father God, we believe that right now, work is going to intensify. We believe that the work of the kingdom of God is going to move us in such a way that we are going to get busy because we are expecting the word of God tonight to prick us, to prick our hearts, to motivate us, to move us. Father, we pray that this don't only be a conference that tickles the air, but God, that it would touch the heart.
Yes, Lord.
Touch the heart of your children. because we believe, God, that you are so concerned about mission. You are so concerned about saving this world that you send your son Jesus to die for us. So Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that this conference would move every heart, would motivate us, would cause us, oh God, to get up and do the work that you have commanded us to do, to go into all the world and share your gospel with every creature, with every man, every woman, boy and girl. And so, Father, we pray tonight that you would touch, Lord God, those that would be ministering tonight. God, that you would touch them in a special way, that every word, God, that they would utter tonight would touch the hearts of your people. God, that you would touch them in such a way, God, that the words, God, that they speak to us tonight in the name of Jesus would move us, would move, oh God, us to get up and go into this, into our world, God, and share and lift up and, oh God, take authority over, God, the things that you have told us to. And so, God, we just thank you. We thank you for every speaker. We thank you for, God, what they will share. God, we pray, God, that our hearts would be receptive to receive your word, that your word would fall on good grounds. And we pray that no devil, oh God, would prick this word from out of our hearts tonight in the name of Jesus. We yes. thank you for this move of God tonight, Father. We thank you, Lord God, for moving, oh God, through the airways, through Zoom. Oh God, moving in us. Oh God, to have your work done in the earth. So right now we give you praise for the move of God that we are expecting tonight. We yes. give you praise for every speaker. Touch them, Father, in Jesus' name. Somebody say amen.
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 Praise God. We want Hallelujah. You to join us now in worshiping Jesus the Christ. Will you join Living Water and Abundant Life Praise Team as we worship the Lord? Come on, put your hands together and rejoice.
Rejoice.
Yes, we're here to rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Hallelujah. We're going to sing to the Lord a new song.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Sing to the Lord all ye earth. I'm gonna dance and praise him. It doesn't matter what comes my way. The greater one lives inside of me. His name is Jesus. I'm born a winner, more than victorious. I'm an heir of his kingdom, filled with the Holy Ghost. Oh, 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 I'm gonna dance and praise him. It doesn't matter what comes my way. The greater one lives inside of me. His name is Jesus. I'm born a winner, more than victorious. I'm an heir of his kingdom, filled with the Holy Ghost. Oh, 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 oh.
No weapon formed against me shall ever prosper. The greater one lives inside of me. His name is Jesus. I'm born a winner, more than victorious. I'm an heir of his kingdom, filled with the Holy Ghost. Oh, 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 oh. No weapon formed against me shall ever prosper. The greater one lives inside of me. His name is Jesus. I'm born a winner, more than victorious. I'm an heir of his kingdom, filled with the Holy Ghost. Whoa, whoa, whoa. I rejoice in him. I rejoice in him. I rejoice in him. I'm more than a conqueror. I rejoice in him. I rejoice in him. I rejoice in him.
Oh, yes.
More than a conqueror. I rejoice in him. I rejoice in him. I rejoice in him. More than a conqueror.
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 I am more than a conqueror.
More than a conqueror.
More than a conqueror.
More than a conqueror.
More than victorious.
More than victorious.
More than victorious.
More than victorious.
I am more than victorious.
More than victorious.
More than victorious.
More than victorious.
Oh, 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 oh. More than a conqueror.
More than a conqueror.
More than the conqueror.
More than a conqueror.
I am more than a conqueror.
More than a conqueror.
More than a conqueror.
More than a conqueror.
More than victorious.
More than victorious.
More than victorious.
More than victorious.
I am more than victorious.
More than victorious.
More than victorious.
More than victorious.
Oh, 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 strong and mighty. Your name is glorious and great. And then we are saved. The name of Jesus, higher than other names. King of all kings, no other name like his. The name of Jesus, higher than other names. Alpha and Omega, no other name like his. Hey, come on, worship them. Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
Hey. Your name like sweet perfume poured upon my soul. Yeah. In your name we overcome. In your name there's victory. His name is powerful. The name of Jesus, higher than other names. King of all kings, no other name like his. The name of Jesus, higher than other names. Alpha and Omega, no other name like it. The name of Jesus, higher than other names. King of all kings, no other name like his. The name of Jesus, higher than other names. Alpha and Omega, no other name like it. Every other god, they're deader than dead. Jesus cried and he rose again. We lift him higher. In your name, every knee shall bow. In your name, all men are saved. We call upon the name. Call his name,
Jesus.
Call that name,
Jesus.
Call that name,
Jesus.
Oh, Jesus. Call that name,
Jesus.
Mighty God,
Jesus.
Marvelous,
Jesus.
Oh, Jesus. Call his name,
Jesus.
Call that name,
Jesus.
Call his name,
Jesus. Oh, Jesus,
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 Jesus, oh, Jesus.
Hallelujah. We worship you, oh God.
Yes, Lord.
We lift you high above all else. There is none like you. You are Jesus, the Son of the living God. We bless your holy name.
Jesus.
Hallelujah. Call his name.
Jesus.
Call that name.
Jesus.
Call that name.
Jesus.
Oh, Jesus. God,
Jesus,
marvelous,
Jesus,
oh,
Jesus,
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 oh,
Jesus.
You can call that name,
Jesus,
in every situation,
Jesus,
whatever it is,
Jesus, oh, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Glory. Come on,
God.
Everyone.
Yes, Lord. Yes,
call
Lord.
On Jesus. Hallelujah. We bless you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Glory to God.
We worship you,
hallelujah,
oh God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
Thank you, Lord. Just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus, your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety, to every soul held captive by depression. I speak Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life.
Hallelujah.
Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name. Jesus, shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the street, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Glory, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We praise you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Somebody needs Jesus right now. Someone needs to call on Jesus. His name is power.
Hallelujah.
His name breaks yokes.
Yes, Lord.
Demons tremble at the sound of that name. Jesus.
Jesus.
Someone needs to call on Jesus right now.
Jesus.
Someone in the hospital needs to call on
Hallelujah.
Jesus. Somebody
Hallelujah.
In the jailhouse needs to call on Jesus.
Jesus.
Somebody in their sick bed needs
Hallelujah.
To call on Jesus.
Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Hallelujah. In this conference, let's call on Jesus.
Jesus.
Oh, glory,
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
We bless
hallelujah.
Your holy name,
hallelujah.
Jesus.
Glory
you
God.
Are everything
hallelujah.
To us. Oh,
thank
bless
you,
the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Glory, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We magnify your name, O God. We worship you, O God. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Somebody just write in that chat group, Jesus. Hallelujah. Jesus. Jesus. Glory, hallelujah. Hallelujah. He is our Lord and Savior. He's our master. Hallelujah. Right now, we're going to call on our Reverend Dr. Patrick Paul, our General Superintendent for the Assemblies of God in the Bahamas and the Turks and Caicos. And Reverend Dr. Paul, for many years, have been encouraging our churches to reach out to the communities, reach out to our islands, reach out to the nations. He's been encouraging us to engage in the seven mountains of culture to make an impact. Hallelujah. That's what the greater works is all about. We need to make an impact so that we can advance the kingdom of God. And he's always emphasized discipleship and evangelism. Right now, we're going to call on Reverend Dr. Patrick Paul to come and greet us this evening.
Congratulations to the Grand Bahama District and, of course, the Presbyter and the Assistant Superintendent, Reverend Robert Lockhart, senior pastors, ministers, and congregation of the Grand Bahama District. As you go into your mission convention, I want to remind you of just four basic things that the scripture teaches us that I believe is paramount for us that are Christian. One, Jesus Christ came to build a church. Two, he came to build character. Three, he came to bring purpose to the church. And four, he came to bring mission to the church. As relates to character, Romans 8 and 29 says, "For whom he foreknew, he also called. And whom he called, he predestinated to be conformed to the image of his son." Character provides a healthy church. And then purpose. The church is with a purpose both inside and out. The inside of the church called to, number one, is that each joint supplied according to the effectual working of the measure of every part, making increase of itself unto the edifying of itself. That's inward ministry. The immediate ministry is its community, filling its community purpose. And then nationally is discipleship. And then globally, we are called to mission. And so we have this responsibility of local mission and global mission. And so as you meet this special time of the year, I want to congratulate you that we are being reset to those things that God has called us to. We're being and also we're being refreshed to those things, and we have leadership who's going to provide us in that area. And so I want to congratulate Pastor Eddie and the district, and my prayers, may the Lord bless you and strengthen you as you serve together and as we advance the course of the kingdom of God here on earth. God bless. Have a great convention.
Thank you so much, Reverend Dr. Patrick Paul. We're just so delighted that he was able to join us tonight. And we thank God for everyone here tonight. Thank you, all for joining us throughout the Grand Bahama District, throughout the Assemblies of God in the Bahamas and Turks and Caicos, and to all our friends throughout the nations of the world who joined us online here at our first Grand Bahama District Missions Conference. Without further ado, our first speaker is ready. Our first speaker is Pastor Ashton Brown. He's the pastor of Clearwater Assembly in Exuma. He's also the district presbyter for Eleuthera and Exuma, and he's the assistant national missions director. Help me welcome Pastor Ashton Brown. Come on, give us an online applause.
Good night, everybody. That praise and worship, calling on the name of Jesus, that just went right to my heart. That just went right to my heart because as we do the mission or do the work that he's called us to do, you realize that he is the root of everything and he's the source of everything. And he is our all in all of everything. So I just want to thank you to let you guys know that song of praise and worship went right to my heart. Well, I have 15 minutes, and so I'm going to make this as concise and as quick as I can. I've been charged with the responsibility to talk about missions and the greater work. And so what I would like to do is to really push or to establish 4 points in this short discourse that I'm going to do. And what the points that I'd like to make is, or for us to understand, to come to talk about is, what is the greater works ministry? Where did the greater, that's the first thing. Secondly is, where did it start? Who are we that we would play a part in this greater work ministry? How do we participate? What is our role? That's the third one. And fourthly, the greater works of Christ and ourselves, how is it manifested? How do we come? And as I was preparing and meditating, just thinking about the greater works ministry, I was saying to myself, where did this start? And so we're going to go to the scriptures really quick and talk about that. I want to acknowledge our general superintendent, Reverend Pastor Paul, our assistant superintendent, my pastor, Pastor Robert Lockhart, and all of my colleagues, the circuit pastors that are here, fellow ministers and colleagues in the gospel, good night. John, I'm going to stick basically to the book of John. And John 5, verse 14, Jesus was speaking to a gentleman that was by the pool and he was ill. And Jesus said this in verse 14, and after Jesus findeth him in the temple, he said unto him, behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more, lest the worst thing come upon you. When you drop to verse 17. What happened was that because what Jesus did, there was some opposition, and Jesus told the people that were opposing him, my Father worketh, hitherto I work. And when you drop to verse 19, it says, then answered Jesus and said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself, but what he seeth the Father do. For what things whatsoever he doeth, these also doeth the Son likewise. For the Father loveth the Son, and showed him all things that himself doeth, and he will show him greater works than these. So we see that the greater works ministry started with Jesus. And we come to understand that Jesus was doing a work. The work that he was doing was what he saw his Father doing. The work that Jesus was doing was his assignment that he was sent to do. And Jesus was referencing the miracle and the signs and wonders that were following him as works that the Father was doing. And so Jesus was actually doing a work in the earth that was assigned to him by the Father when he came. The greater work started with Jesus. And I want us to know that to accomplish, and it is God's intent for us to accomplish this greater work with him. Jesus, while he was here in John 20, 19, 20, he says, as the Father sent me to do just what Jesus was doing here in John 5, as the Father sent me, so send I you, blew on them and say, receive the Holy Ghost and go and do the greater work. I want us to understand something also really quick. I remember now, I'm talking about what is the greater work? The greater work ministries is the work that Jesus did when he was in the earth. What did Jesus do? It was shown here that Jesus dealt with sin. He healed the man. The scripture teaches us that Jesus went about doing good and healing people of all manner of diseases. And what he was doing was destroying the work that sin had on the people. And he was preaching and teaching the gospel and bringing people into the kingdom of God, or bringing them under the rulership of God. That is the work that Jesus was assigned to do. The work that Jesus was assigned to do was to restore the image and likeness of God in the earth. Sister DeLinda referenced the scripture in John 14 about Jesus being the express image. Let me just go there really quick. Jesus said in John 14, when Philip asked, show us the Father. Philip said unto him, Lord, show us the Father, and it suffices us. Jesus said unto him, have I been so long with you as yet? Has thou not known me, Philip? He that has seen me has seen the Father, and how said thou, show us the Father? Before that, in verse 7, when Jesus said unto them, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. If you had known me, you should have known my Father also. And from henceforth, you know him and have seen him. What Jesus is saying here that I want us to understand as a church, as a district, is that Christ had an assignment. Christ came to restore and to be the reflection of the image and the likeness of God in earth, like the first Adam. Superintendent referenced character. Christ came to reestablish the character and the image of God. And because of that, when we read John 5, the Bible says that God testified, or God confirmed what Jesus was doing by the signs and wonders. Here's what he said. I received not the testimony from man, but the things that ye might be saved. But these things I say that ye might be saved. And he's talking about John. He says he was a burning and a shining light, and ye were willing for a season to rejoice in his light. But I have greater witness than that of John. For the works, right back to this works, which the Father has given me to finish, the same works that I do, bear witness of me that the Father has sent me. What I want us to understand, that as we are sons of God, like Jesus was, there is an assignment that we have in the earth. And the assignment that we have in the earth is to finish the work that God has called us to do, which is the work of God to destroy the works of the enemy. Jesus came and dealt with the sin factor. Jesus restored us in relationship with God by dying as the perfect sacrifice. And then he left. And as Jesus made disciples, that was his assignment in John 17. He says, all those that you've given me, Father, I've lost none except the son of perdition. And I've given them your word. I've made disciples of them. And for that, the assignment is complete. I destroyed the work of sin in their lives. Jesus mentioned in John 5 about the man at the pool. He says, he healed him and then said, go and sin no more. The man that was let down through the roof, who was paralyzed, he says, your sin be forgiven thee. We also play a part in the forgiveness of sin, because Jesus says, whoever sins you remit is remitted. When we preach the gospel, which is a part of the greater work, like Jesus did, when we declare repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand, and we speak and we teach of the sovereignty of Jesus, of the fact that Jesus is the Son of God. He is the way, the truth, and the life, and the way to the Father. And we preach this gospel and others hear and accept the word. That is a part of the greater works ministry that that God has called us to. So I want us to understand that we have been called. When we accept this greater work ministry, just like the Father, he says, but I have a greater witness, John 5:36, than that of John, for the works which the Father has given me to finish, the same works that I do, bear witness of me that the Father sent me. And the Father himself which has sent me has borne witness of me. He neither, so I want us to understand, once we embark on this greater work, we can expect the Father to bear witness of us. That is the command that we have been given. And I want us to understand too, when Jesus was referencing John, here's what he said. John said, I indeed baptize you with water. But there's one that's coming after me that's going to baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Jesus, when he was leaving in John 20, he blew on his disciples, gave them the assignment officially, as the Father sent me to do the greater works, I now send you. John prophesied that I'd give you the Holy Ghost. Take this Holy Ghost and do the greater work. That was the command to the church. As the church, as the body of Christ, we ought to understand. And as I was preparing for this, a clear line of demarcation was made in my mind. We can either be like John the Baptist, we can either accept John the Baptist baptism and stay there, which is to be baptized by water, come up in newness of life, and sit in the church. Or we can take the next step and be baptized by the Holy Ghost and fire with Jesus Christ, and then go into the greater works ministry. It takes the Holy Ghost and fire and the passion that was given to the apostles in the upper room. I want to encourage us today, those of us that have not received the Holy Ghost or is not walking in the passion and the fire, I pray that the fire of God is rekindled in our lives, that we would take up and we would be endued with passion again to do the work, the greater works, which is to go into all the world, to preach this gospel, to teach them to observe what Jesus taught, and to make disciples. Like Sister Margo said, our superintendent has been talking about discipleship for the past few weeks. As a denomination, we've been talking about discipleship. Let me start again in January. We'll be back in the discipleship, because that is a part of the greater works that we've been called to. We have to understand that the passion and the drive that we need to do this greater work is given to us when here's what Christ said, Philip, do you not understand that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The promise of the Father is the Holy Ghost. When we submit ourselves to God and we're filled with the Holy Ghost, now not only is the Father in Christ and Christ in the Father, but we become a part of the Trinity, because the Holy Ghost that is in us now brings Christ and the Father to abide in us, and we abide in him. And so John 17 is fulfilled. We become one with the Father and the Father with us. And then we have the mind of Christ, and we have a drive and a passion to do the greater works. When we talk about work, we talk about labor. Here's what Jesus said. Labor not for meat that perisheth. In other words, do not work for meat that perish, but labor for meat that would be fruitful unto eternal life. This cannot happen until we intensify our relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, until we yield to and follow the Holy Spirit, or follow the word of God, which is Spirit, and give ourselves to the things of God. And then what Jesus said in John 4, my meat or my passion or my drive, because he came to fulfill the works of God in the earth, which is to destroy the work of the enemy, according to 1 John 3:8. And that is our assignment. That is the assignment of the church, according to Ephesians 3. It was always God's intent to put the church on display, to show his manifold wisdom, the principalities and powers, and to destroy their works in the earth. And so it is my prayer tonight that we come to the place that we understand and we yield to God with the passion and the drive to become the missionaries, to become the evangelists, to become the apostles that God has called us to do, for us to do the greater works that he's called us to be, to impact our own lives, to impact our families, to impact our communities, and to impact our nation for the kingdom of God, and to declare the kingdom of God is at hand, and so that he can confirm it with the signs and wonders, and we can go to the rescue of the lost and dying, not only from the spiritual perspective, but from the natural perspective, that we can be shepherds and lead our sheep to green pastures and to lead them to the Lord Jesus Christ. Because the work that Christ came to do, that he's assigned us to, is to be ministers of reconciliation, reconciling the world back to God. I just wanted us to get a brief understanding with the short time that I have. What is the greater works? The greater works is the works of Jesus Christ that he's assigned us to be. Where did it start? It started with Jesus. When he did what he saw the Father do and said what the Father, he said what the Father did and did what the Father said. And so he was God. Listen to this. God was in Christ doing the work himself, drawing man to him by his Spirit. And now the mystery that was hid is that Christ is in us to do the greater work through us, to destroy the works of the enemy, and to bring men back into the wholeness or into reconciliation with God, restoring the image and the likeness of Christ in the earth. That is the greater work. The greater work is that of the Good Samaritan, to meet the needs of those that are in need and less fortunate. The greater works is to preach the gospel. The greater works is to cast out devils. The greater work is to heal the sick. The greater work is to minister the word of God. That is the greater work. Father, I pray that there would be a fresh outpouring of your Holy Spirit in the midst of the Assemblies of God, in the midst of the Grand Bahama District. I pray, O Holy Father, that you, by your Holy Spirit, would move in a fresh way, that your wind would blow, one more time, that the Holy Spirit, we would have a fresh infilling of your Holy Spirit with new fire and new zeal. And our meat would be to do the will of him that sent us and to complete it. And that you would fill us with the knowledge of your will and the wisdom to execute it, so that we could subdue principalities, powers, oh God, judge, dominions, all things that hinder your work. And the Christ in us would rise up and complete the work that's been started, so we could usher in your millennium kingdom and go into eternity with you, to be with you forever, worlds without end. We thank you for our part in the greater work. In Jesus' name, you be blessed.
Amen. To God be the glory. Bless the Lord. Can we just give God a praise right now, right there in that chat group? Let's give God a praise. We thank God for Pastor Ashton Brown, who himself has gone out into the islands and is a great missionary in Exuma, pastoring Clearwater Assembly. And we thank God for that word, Pastor Ashton Brown. Yes, this greater works began with Jesus, but he expects us to carry on this great work and greater works, he says, that we shall do. Amen. Everything that Jesus did, he expects us to do, but there's even more to do. And we're responsible. We are accountable to Jesus to continue this work. Amen. Let's just give God a praise. Now, we need to make a great appeal for this greater works to be done. And we're going to call our assistant superintendent to come. That is Pastor Reverend Dr. Robert Lockhart, who is going to come right now and give us that mission appeal.
Good evening. Thank you so much, Pastor Margo Victor, our moderator for tonight, our district presbyter, Pastor Eddie Victor. We thank God for you, Pastor Edward Victor, and also our district general press secretary, or treasurer rather, of the Assemblies of God in the Bahamas. We thank God for him and his leadership, and also our mission, our district missions director. We thank God for our minister, Michelle Britton, all the pastors, all of our church leaders, all of our members, followers of the Assemblies of God. Here we just thank God for all of you that are on via Zoom and via Facebook. We thank God for you tonight. But we have a very important part that we want to talk to you about, and it is about the mission giving. And I want to talk about that tonight. It's talking about our mission giving, and what we have is these cards are available for you, and your churches, each of your churches will have one of them that's available, mission pledge giving. And tonight we want you to consider prayerfully what you'll have the Lord have you pledge for the year 2022. That's just a couple of weeks away from us, in which your pledge would be a monthly pledge, a one-time giving pledge that you will give to the mission of your church. Amen. And by virtue also, I believe the mission, the ministry of the church will also give to the National Missions Department. But these cards that are going to be presented tonight, and you can get them from your church, your pastor, if they have not done so already, will be doing so in the next coming Sundays, presenting these pledge cards to you, mission pledge cards, which you're going to give monthly or quarterly or maybe twice a year or once a year, which you promise that you will give to missions, amen, to help the ministry of your church with its mission and thrust. I want to read a scripture to you from Philippians chapter 4, verse 16 and verse 18, and this is what it says. Even in Thessalonica, you sent me help for my needs once again. Not that I seek the gift, but I seek the fruit that increases to your credit. I have received full payment and more. I am well supplied, having received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent, a fragrant offering, a sacrifice acceptable and pleasing to God. And what the Apostle Paul was talking about here was the Church of Thessalonica, they had sent him support to help him carry out the ministry and the work that God had assigned him to do as a church planter, amen, and setting up churches in Asia Minor at that time. And that work was carried out by the Apostle Paul, because there were believers, amen, like Epaphroditus and the church of Thessalonica, that took up special offerings, amen, and sent it to men like the Apostle Paul, whom God had sent out. Amen. That's what the word apostle means, one sent. And our modern term for that is missionary. Amen. They were doing missionary work. And that's a part of the apostolic work, is to go out, amen, win the lost, plant churches. And this is what this mission offering is going to do. And we want to see every church begin to increase, amen, in its mission giving, amen, so that every church can be able to support those that God would send, amen, to go out to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ, to plant churches. And so we thank God for them. We thank God for our Pastor Ashton Brown, who's answered the call of God and has gone out. He's one of us from the Grand Bahama District, amen, and we want to thank God for him. But we need to be able to support him and support others like him. And so we want to be able to do that, and those that would go. And so I would encourage every one of you to get one of these cards, amen. If you have one tonight, or you can, if you have received one already that you've gotten from your church, we want you to fill it out, amen, and allow the Lord to lead you and say, this is my weekly giving, my monthly giving, or my one-time donation. But I know you're not going to have a one-time donation unless you're going to add up all those months, amen. But I want to encourage you, let's give weekly, let's give monthly to missions. And as the Lord directs you tonight, we want you to do that in the name of the Lord. And as the scripture says, inside the book of Philippians 4:16 and actually verse 18, he says, a fragrant offering, a sacrifice acceptable and pleasing to God. When we support missionaries, when we support evangelism, when we support missions with our finances, amen, with our resources, amen, by going and by sending. All of us may not be able to go, but all of us can give and help those go, amen, who God has called to take the gospel to the lost, take it to cities, to regions, to nations, amen. And so make sure I get one of these, and we're going to make them available to you. And so what I would want to do, and Minister Margo, Victor, you can let me know. I don't know if I can go and say a prayer over it, or you have someone to sign.
Yes, please do.
Yes. And so tonight, amen, I want you, if you don't have the pledge cards in front of you, write something down right now that the Lord has spoken to your heart. Maybe the Lord tells you to give $50 a week, or $50 a month, or $100 a month, or $500 a month, or $1,000 a month, or $3,000 a year. Whatever it is the Lord speaks, you write it down and say, Lord, I'm believing you every month, every week and every month, to provide me with my missions giving, because we are going to commit ourselves to the assignment that God has given to us. And so that those that answer the call, amen, of going that they can go and do not have to worry about their needs being met, because all of us as children of God are participating in this great assignment that we have as the church, to go and to send and to go and to make sure that the gospel gets to everyone that needs to hear it, which is everybody. So I want us to pray right now. Just bow with me in the name of the Lord. Father, we just thank you right now as we listen to the voice of God. Oh God, the Heavenly Father, that we'll recommit ourselves to mission giving, oh God and Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus. And that, oh God, all of our churches in the Grand Bahama District, oh God, that Heavenly Father would see the missions, giving, and offerings increase, oh God, so that we could support our missionaries. We can support missions. We can support, oh God, evangelistic outreaches and thrusts, oh God, and Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus. Support the preacher. Support, oh God, the need to be able to help the poor. Support, oh God, to pray, pay for people to go where they need to go, for transportation, for travel, oh God, and Heavenly Father, for housing, in the name of Jesus, to support those on the mission field, oh God, so that their need will be met. And so, Father, right now, as you speak to our hearts, help us to write down a figure, that $50, that $100, that $500, that $1,000, whatever it is that you have given us the ability to give, Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for it. And we thank you right now that we will see increase in our churches, in our district, in regards to missions giving, and, oh God, and be a part of that greater work that you've called us to do. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and everybody say amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Pastor Lockhart. And you know, we just thank God for his words of encouragement. You know, friends, if you have never given to missions before, giving tonight or beginning to give to your church in the Grand Bahama District to do missions is a greater work that you're doing. Hallelujah. And so we just thank God that appeal has gone out. Now it's on you. Will you give to the greater works? You know, Romans 10 and 15 says, and how shall they preach unless they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. So we are expecting you to fill out that form. Go to your church in the Grand Bahama District, and they will have that form for you. But you can also look online, and we have online forms for you to fill out, and it will go directly to the church that you want to send it to. It's in the Zoom chat, and it's also on Facebook. To God be the glory. Aren't you excited about the greater works and that God has called you to do this greater work? Right now, you are going to be blessed by a solo by Sister Jackie Williams of Calvary Temple, singing The Goodness of God.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never failed me. All my days have been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so with every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. darkest night. You are strength like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. Yes, 'cause all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every prayer of the goodness of God. Yes, 'cause your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your it's running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your it's running after, it's running after me. Hallelujah, Jesus. In all my life, you have been faithful. All my life, you have been so, so good. With every breath of the goodness of God. Yes, hallelujah. With all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath we serve a mighty and a great God, for he is worthy to be praised.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you so much, Sister Jackie Williams. That was a blessing. She's always a blessing. And we just thank God for the gift of God in her ministry. Right now, we're going to move right on. We are getting through this program really nicely. And we thank God for all of you who've joined us tonight. Right now, we're going to call Reverend Dr. Eddie Victor, who's the presbyter for the Grand Bahama District. And he's going to come and bless you with the word tonight. Greater works. Someone just type in greater works as Pastor Victor comes.
Good evening, everyone. It is truly an honor and a pleasure to be with you tonight and to be able to come to you through this platform for our first, as you've heard it, our first district mission conference. We believe that it is time for us as as a district to enter into the greater work dimension. I want to give honor and respect to our superintendent, Reverend Dr. Patrick Paul. Our assistant superintendent is with us tonight, Reverend Dr. Robert Lockhart. Also want to give thank God for our district leadership. And we thank God for Dudley Francis and also my wife of 30 years, Pastor Margo Victor. I remember an elder when me and my wife was on radio and we were doing a regular show at that time. And the elder told me, say, Pastor, you could preach good, but I like to listen to your wife more. So thank God for the wife that God has given me. I want us to realize that we're in a time and an era where we must do greater works, and especially when it comes to advancing the kingdom of God. We had a fantastic word from Pastor Ashton Brown. I've had the pleasure of working with this man of God for a number of years, especially in the area of evangelism. I see his passion, I see his heart. Ashton Brown is our national missionary. He's our only national missionary at this time, really, when you kind of look at it. And we support him. Our church supports Pastor Ashton Brown. And we're hoping that and I want to thank Pastor Lockhart for that powerful prayer and charge concerning mission giving. Because we believe that as God gives more funds for missions into each of our churches, and as their leadership decides on these missions support, that all of our churches will give to district mission, to national mission, and to international missions. And so I want us to begin to think bigger than how we've been thinking. And I want to talk to you on this topic, the sky is the limit. And I'm going to invite you to turn with me to Genesis chapter 15, and I'm going to read verses 1-6. Genesis chapter 15, verses 1-6. And the word of God reads as this. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield and your exceedingly great reward. But Abram said, Lord God, what will you give me, seeing I go childless, and the heir of my house, Eliezer of Damascus? Then Abram said, look, you have given me no offspring. Indeed, one born in my house is my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, saying, this one shall not be your heir, but one who will come from your own body shall be your heir. Then he brought him outside and said, look now towards the heaven and count the stars, if you're able to number them. And he said to him, so shall your descendants be. In verse 6, and he believed in the Lord, and he accounted it to him for righteousness. Let's just pray for just a moment. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray in these moments we have together that, Lord, that we will begin to think bigger, that we will begin to do greater works in your name, and that, Lord, that you will be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. You heard said earlier from our district mission director about the many evangelistic activities that is taking place in the district: outreach, children's mini, stoplight ministry, prayer walks, giving out tracts. But with all that activity, the reality is there's only a few people that are actually involved in reaching out to people in the community and this island. The fact is that all of us should be in this work because we're all called to reach out to people in our communities, our city, and our country. But God is calling us to do a greater dimension of work. And what we see is that God, when it came to Abraham, was expanding Abraham's thinking. And in order to do that, God took him outside and he said, look to the heavens, look to the sky. And he's telling him, you know, that as he looks to the sky and he looked to the heaven, and he says that if you're able to count all these stars, so shall your descendants be. In other words, he was saying that the sky is the limit. When we look at that phrase, we have to realize that that phrase really means there is no limit. And that's what God was saying to Abraham. There's no limit to what I can do with you. Because when we look into the heavens and we look into the great expanse that God created, it is endless. We can't count the stars. We can't count the galaxies. We can't count the cosmos and the expanse because it's vast. It's endless. And so are the possibilities in God. There is nothing that we can't do through God. And God was revealing to Abraham. I mean, I might as well tell you, there was no flat screen television or big screen television in those days. So God showed him the sky. And I guess that's the biggest television you could see. Because he wanted to change Abraham's thinking. Jesus had to expand the thinking of the disciples when he first called them to follow him. Luke chapter 5 reveals to us that Jesus was on the lakeside, and he went into Simon Peter's boat, and he told Simon to to just go offshore a little bit. And from that boat, Jesus began to teach about the kingdom of God. And then after he was finished teaching, what we have to remember with this particular story is that when Jesus went into the boat, this was already at the end of a day, long day of fishing. They caught nothing and they were cleaning their nets. They were winding down the end of the day. They were closing shop. But we see that after Jesus was finished teaching, he said to Peter, he said, launch out in the deep and let down your nets. And let me just read to you what Simon's answer was. It says, Simon answered and said to him, Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net. And when he had done this, they caught a great number of fish and their nets were breaking. So they signaled to their partners and other boats to come and help them. And they came and filled up the boat so that they began to sink. And when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees saying, depart from me, for I am a sinner, O Lord. For he and all who was with him was astonished at the catch of fish which they had taken. Simon Peter's economy changed in a moment because he followed the word of Jesus. And because of that manifestation where he didn't catch nothing earlier. His boat was now full of fish. His partner's boat was full of fish, and so much so that the boat was sinking. Their economy changed in one day. And because Simon Peter's thinking expanded, the Bible says that he came into the kingdom of God. He recognized that he was a sinner. And from that moment afterwards, him and his partners followed Jesus. In fact, the Bible says they left everything and they followed him. You see, if we're going to do greater works in this season we're in, we got to realize that the harvest is the greatest it has ever been in human history. You know, some people will say that the gospel has gone everywhere and that we don't need to go into certain areas. We must try to go, yes, we must try to go into places where no one has heard the gospel before. But I'm telling you that the greatest harvest that we've ever seen is here now. But what needs to happen? We need more laborers. We need believers who need to do greater works. And this work must have finances. So what has to happen is we have to remove the limits of our lives in order for us to enter into the greater work dimension. So how does a person remove these limits? I want to give you five, I believe, important principles that will help you to begin to realize that I'm called for greater works. Number one, believe the word of the Lord. It sounds very simple, but you have to recognize that when it came to Simon Peter had already had an experience where he caught no fish. But he said something which was so powerful when Jesus said, launch out into the deep and cast out the net. He said, at your word, even though nothing happened all day, but at your word, I'm going to do what you said. And because he did what Jesus said, only by a word from God, he experienced a transformation in his spiritual life. And the economy of his business was transformed in a moment. What we have to realize is that we're in a time when we have to follow what God is saying to you to do. And you just have to trust God no matter what comes up, no matter what tries to destabilize you and to try to get you off track. Just follow whatever God has said. You have to trust the word of the Lord and believe the word of the Lord. Number two, you got to think big. You have to think big. Tell someone, put it in the chat, think big. Proverbs 23 and 7, for as he thinks in his heart, so is he. As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. If you think small, you will experience small things. But if you think big, doesn't matter if you are, doesn't matter what your stature is, doesn't matter what your height is, but if you think big, you'll do greater things. You see, I have to say this, and our superintendent, Reverend Patrick Paul, from the years that I know him, he's always thinking big. He always has some amazing ideas, and some people really can't, you know, grasp it at the moment he shares it. But I have been around him long enough, and I say, boy, he come up with some ideas, and I know these are good ideas, and I know these are big ideas. Like right now, as a fellowship and as churches, we're being encouraged to get involved with the church commercial farming group, and this is taking farming to a national commercial level. And we're talking about being able to feed ourselves as a nation. And this is a big thing now, food security. You heard about supply chain blockages right now. Food security is a very, very real issue. But he's talking about us producing food for ourselves, feeding ourselves, and then taking it to a commercial level where we can not only supply the nation, but export to other countries. This is a transforming big idea. That's thinking big. You know, when you talk about thinking big, the Lord a few years ago reminded me about something when I was about 8 or 9 years old. I think it's more like 9 or 10 years old. Me and our next door neighbor, we used to dream about owning airplanes and actually running charter services and airline. I'm telling you, that's children. We can't afford to buy nothing for ourselves, but we are thinking about planes. And so what I did as a child, I began to write these airline companies. And we didn't have computers. I didn't have a typewriter. All I had was plain paper and a pen, and I'm 10 years old. And I'm writing letters to these multi-million dollar airplane companies, asking them to send me brochures because I'm interested in their planes. Not only did I write the letter and I printed it in pen, I put it in an envelope, gave it to my father, and my father mailed it for me, and the people replied and sent me brochures at 10 years old. I'm looking at Learjets, like the Grumman jets, and all these Cessnas and all these companies. I had the brochures at 10 years old. And the reason the Lord brought me back there to that point in my life, because he told me that I need to dream again. And some of us, because of the trials and tribulations of life, things have got us to a place where we begin to think that we can't do nothing, we can't accomplish nothing. But if a 10-year-old can write airplane companies, multi-million airplane companies, write letters and ask for brochures, and they responded, you can do anything. It's time to think big. Number three, initiate your faith. Initiate your faith. Matthew 17 and 20. So Jesus said to them, because of your unbelief, and assuredly I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you will be able to say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. The next important point is to ask God for more faith. Luke 17 and 15, we see that the apostle said to the Lord, increase our faith. You see, you must initiate faith. And if you are faced with a challenge and a circumstance and you believe you need more faith, you could ask God, give me more faith, because we have great work to do. We have people to win in our community. We have people to win on this island. We have people to win in this nation. And there are other nations that the Lord wants us to go to. We got Pastor Lockhart, who has been traveling now regularly to the United States. He is doing 10 crusades in cities, winning people for the Lord. We need to go to the nations because God has given us a message to preach that gospel. And my final point is this: embrace opportunities to expand. And this is a very important point, because I call this the greatest miracle that didn't happen. We see that in Matthew chapter 14, and verse 16, Jesus, there are 5,000 people. They've been there listening to the message of the gospel of the kingdom of God, his teaching. And the disciples wanted to send them away because it's time for dinner. It's time for people to eat. But Jesus looks at the disciples and says to them, he says this, there's no need to send them away. You give them something to eat. Jesus intended for the 5,000 to be fed through the disciples. But the disciples did not have the faith. That was an opportunity to expand. But they did not have the faith to exercise their faith, to initiate their faith and enter into a greater work dimension. The story should have read, the disciples fed the 5,000. But instead, it said that Jesus fed the 5,000 and he had to address them because of their faith. We have to embrace opportunities. I want to thank God for me and my wife. We embraced opportunities after the hurricane. 70% of our island was flooded. And when we recognized that our home was spared and the people in our immediate neighborhood were spared, we committed ourselves to go in to help people to restore their lives. 2 days after the hurricane, airplane after airplane, people were sending us airplane loads of supplies. And we distributed them. And you know, and as we embraced this opportunity to minister to people, we began to say we needed a warehouse, and we were looking for a warehouse. But then the Grand Bahama Disaster Relief Foundation, working along with Israel Aid, we were able to set up a warehouse and they turned control of anything that came in from the Disaster Relief Foundation for under the control of Pastor Margo and myself to distribute. So we got our warehouse and people were sending us trailers to our ministry and we distributed them. And then we were able to distribute our beds, new brand new mattresses. Then we were able to distribute furniture to outfit a whole home. And then we were able to distribute brand new appliances. It was amazing, the opportunities that happened because we embraced opportunities to do greater works. We embraced opportunities to expand. I thank God as a church, Living Water, we have been supporting missions. We support our national missionary, Pastor Ashton Brown. We support Builders International. And when we were sending support to Builders, the first time we sent support to Builders International, I got a call from them. And they said, Pastor, where do you want your gift to go? And I told them, well, wherever it's most needed. They said, well, we got a church work in Spain. So we began, you know, sending our support to go and build that church in Spain. You know, and one of the reasons why we began to give to Builders International, we began to give to Samaritan Purse, to Water Mission, to Convoy of Hope, because these NGOs poured millions of dollars into our economy when we needed help after Hurricane Dorian. And so our giving is to merely say thank you to what they have done for us. And so we thank God for all those NGOs, everything they've done for us. We thank God for our national missionary. And tonight, as you pledge to give to your church and the leadership of your church, your pastor and his team, they're going to make a decision on how they're going to distribute these mission funds. You are helping to advance the gospel so we can do greater works. So I encourage everyone today, make a decision, decide what you're going to do, pledge and help our district become a mission, a true mission given district. And whatever we do will be done for the glory of God. The sky is the limit. Think big and let's do greater works together in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.
Thank you so much, I'm Pastor Eddie Victor. You've just heard from our presbyter, and it's all about greater works. And so I know you are ready to give to this work of the kingdom. And why don't we call Minister Michelle Burton, who is our district missions director, and I'll let her give you the next appeal to support this mission on the Grand Bahama District. So let's call Minister Michelle. Will you please come?
Good evening again. Pastor Lockhart did such an excellent job. I figured I didn't need to come on. But this work is so important. We make several appeals for those who may just be joining us. And I just found out today that today is Global Giving Tuesday. So how appropriate. And you know, talking about thinking big, I was just last week just calling in billions of dollars from all those billionaires who don't know what to do with their money. They need to release God's money for us to take this Amen. Gospel to the nations. And so I just want to make a brief appeal since you know, Pastor did such a great job already. And I'm just reminded of 1 Chronicles 29, 13 to 16 that I want to read. It says, O our God, we thank you and praise your glorious name. But who am I and who are my people that we would give anything to you? Everything we have has come from you, and we give only what you first gave us. We are here for only a moment, visitors and strangers in the land as our ancestors were before us. Our days on earth are like a passing shadow, gone so soon without a trace. O Lord, our God, even this material we have gathered to build a temple to honor your holy name comes from you. It all belongs to you. And so all we're simply saying tonight, as the Lord enables you, as the Lord blesses you, we're just encouraging you to sow, to be a part of this great work and the greater works that God is preparing his people in the earth to do, because Jesus is on the way. The signs all around, and we need to get this gospel out more than ever before. And so we're just encouraging you, invest in the kingdom of God. You've already seen the missions pledge card. You can give one time, which is due on December 15th. Or you can do it weekly or monthly. It is an honor and a privilege for us to be co-laborers together with God and to sow into his great work. And so we appeal to you, make this investment in the kingdom of God. Souls are God's heartbeat. You can't make no greater investment in this earth. Let's take as many people with us to heaven. Let's sow our lives. Let's sow our resources. Everything that God has blessed us with, it came from him. And all he's saying is, come a little piece back. I asking you for all. He may ask you for all because all belongs to him anyway. But he's saying, partner with me. So whatever he whispers to you, follow the leading of the Holy Spirit, because he will provide seed for the sower. I'm a testament. God has do some, awesome things right in famine. He waits for famine to show himself strong. And so we're encouraging you to be a part of what God is doing in the earth. The Lord Jesus is on the way, and he says, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be. So let's sow into the work of the Lord. Let's be about our Father's business. God bless you as you give and multiply back to you in ways only he can. God bless you tonight.
Amen. Thank you so much, Minister Michelle. I believe everyone watching right now is very excited about giving toward these greater works. It's very important. We know that God wants us to do greater things. Just imagine Grand Bahama Island, who's been hit by Hurricane Dorian. And in the midst of this pandemic, we are doing greater works because you are giving for missions. So come on, let's give to your church to do greater works. Go ahead and do that. And right now, we're going to call our next presenter. And this is Scott Warren, and he represents Builders International. Builders International, an organization that has been to Grand Bahama and that continues to help us after Hurricane Dorian. Let's call Scott Warren. Okay. Just one more second and we'll see. All right, here he comes. Can you check your mic, please?
Yes, hello.
Thank you.
Okay. We got logged out here. Am I on?
You are on. We can hear you.
Okay. Hey, good evening, everybody. I'm here with my lovely wife, Lilia, and Ryan Moore, the CEO of Builders International. Those were some great words tonight, encouraging words. And
welcome.
I just want to share about just a taste of what's going on in the world. Again, you know what's going on in your district, but at Builders International, I'm at the headquarters right now, the Assemblies of God in Springfield, Missouri. We just came out of a huge meeting just talking about the impact of world missions in the Assemblies of God, what is going on around the world. And just my brother Eddie Victor was sharing a few minutes ago, and he said something about the global supply chain. Okay, let me tell you something. The global supply chain is jacked up. It is broken. It is in an absolute mess. You're feeling it in the Bahamas. We're feeling it here in the U.S. But I'm going to tell you about another supply chain. And you guys are going to get excited about this because the globe, the supply chain that we work for, that you work for, that's the supply chain of God. And it is not broken. It's working on, it's running on all cylinders. It's fine-tuned and it is tearing things up. I'm going to go back to the beginning of COVID, a little over a year and a half. We were on the phone with Patrick, Paul, Eddie, Victor, just sharing things. You know what? We're based on people going out and doing the work. We said, what are we going to do? We're dead in the water. And but we took it to God and do this Zoom call. We were able to share the needs and share the experiences out there with everybody live. So we had planned on doing about 35 projects around the world this past year. And again, everybody said this, the global supply chain's broken. We're not going to be able to get any supplies. But because of the faithful giving of the Victor family, the Patrick Paul and his wonderful wife and faithful pastors like yourselves, mission giving has been going up. And again, we thought we were only going to be able to complete 30 projects around the world with everything going good. But the miracle is that just today, we have completed over 100 projects around the world when we thought we were only going to do 30 at a good time. So God is moving in a powerful way. People are getting saved. Again, it is the last time. These are the last days. And your missions giving, I know you all filled out your card a few minutes ago. I want you to scratch off that number, whatever you put on there. We're going to stretch our faith here. We want to have a receiver mentality. We want to have a giving, a going mentality. My brother Jonathan Carey on here, he preaches about this, writes about it all the time. We want to have a giving mentality, and we want to invite you all in the Bahamas to join us all around the world as soon as things open up to come alongside us. Let's swing some hammers. Let's help build these churches and orphanages, these sex trafficking refugees, these schools for our missionaries that are out there that have left it all, the comforts of home. They've just put themselves out there, and for the Lord's call, they're making huge impacts around the world. And you never hear it on the news. People don't talk about it. Oh, the impact, what's the church doing? The church is not dead. It is alive. It's powerful, and it is moving. Every dollar you give to missions, it's being put to work, put to use, and souls are being saved. And again, Builders International, my family here, we want to thank you all for everything that you all have been doing for the kingdom. And in the Bahamas, we've taken over that project. Again, we're working alongside you all at Camp Abaco down in the Bahamas, tremendous project. And God is doing a great work down there through you all. Thanks for all you. God bless you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. That's Scott Warren from Builders International. Friends, aren't you all excited about giving? I feel like scratching out my card. I filled it out about a week ago and adding some more money to it. And that's the truth. I think I'm going to add something else to that card because this is exciting. God's work is exciting. Greater works. We want to do more. Every one of you, give more and God will truly bless you. He'll increase you. He'll expand the work that he has already entrusted to you. And imagine your church, Calvary Temple, Eternal Life, West Side, Abundant Life, Living Water. Imagine that you are doing even more. So please scratch out that number you put and put even more, okay? Praise God. Right now, we're going to call Calvary Temple Praise Team to do a special selection, Great Things. And while they are doing that selection, we want you to give a special offering to the Grand Bahama District for the expenses of this conference. We are going to put up the information for you to give online. So please pay attention to the post that's going to come up so that you can give to the Grand Bahama District. Minister Michelle talked about all the things that the Grand Bahama District is doing, and those are great works, but there are many expenses even for this conference. So please give, we're going to call Calvary Temple to minister to us right now. Let's worship with them.
We came to declare great things.
Expecting great things. I'm expecting great things. I'm expecting great things. Great things. Come on, let's sing that right there. I'm expecting great things.
Awesome. Are you expecting great things?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. I'm feeling it. I'm expecting it. We thank God for that selection of worship from Calvary Temple. Now, ladies and gentlemen, from the Grand Bahama District, those of you who are visiting us from throughout the nations of the world and throughout the Bahamas and the Turks and Caicos, I just want to encourage you to give an offering to the Grand Bahama District. And this is separate and apart from your pledge. If you would like to sow into the Grand Bahama District, we're going to have that information posted right now. In the Bahamas, the bank account will come up, as well as if you are in the U.S., the Cash App information will come up. That information is for an online seed that you want to sow to the Grand Bahama District, separate and apart from your pledge. So you can go ahead and do that right now as the information comes up. We are having an awesome time and we're expecting great things. Right now, our third and final speaker for the night is Reverend Dr. Jonathan Carey, and he is the founder of CTC Network and pastor of Glad Tidings Tabernacle in Key West. But Reverend Carey is from Grand Bahama. He is one of our very own. So we just thank God that he's joined us for this first District Missions Conference. Welcome, Pastor Carey.
Good evening, and thank you for the opportunity to share with you tonight. I know the hour is late, so I'm not going to take all the time allotted to me. I want to give honor to the leaders of your fellowship and to the pastors, for those who are tuned in on this first District Missions Conference. We know that missions is God's heart. And I want to share from the scripture that has been given to us for this conference, John chapter 14. And I hope you have a pen and a paper and just write down some brief notes. I promise I will not take the 35 minutes allowed and allotted to me tonight. We have heard some fantastic revelation and nuggets of truth from God's word. We have had some powerful singing. We have had a powerful time of prayer. And I believe that God has just asked me to share his heart for this particular moment, and then we can move on. In John chapter 14, and if you're going to write some notes, I would just write the word assignments. I think what is lost in a lot of our understanding of John chapter 14, I grew up in Bible school where we taught that greater works simply meant that because the Holy Spirit dwells in us and Jesus went back to the Father, that we would do greater works in quantity, but not necessarily in quality. I believe that that is true to a point, but God does have a greater work for us to do because of assignments. Jesus came into the world not as the creator. Rather, he came as the savior and as the mediator between God and man. And so he came into the earth as the Son of Man to fulfill his assignment. God has an assignment for every one of us. And we were crafted and given the experiences. We were given the abilities. We were given the spiritual gifts that were necessary for us to fulfill our assignment. And as Reverend Dr. Patrick Paul shared, that God has left that great assignment to the church, which is simply to disciple all nations. And so as we look at the scripture, it tells us in John chapter 14, beginning at verse 8, Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is sufficient for us. There are two levels of belief that all of us can occupy. And one level is that we take God at his word. The other level is that seeing is believing. And so the Lord said to Philip, if you can't accept what I say, then accept what you see. I want to say to us in the Grand Bahama District that it's very important for us to have ears that are bent towards the voice of the Holy Spirit. 10 years ago, when I became the pastor of this great church, Glad Tidings Tabernacle, we had a hefty mortgage. And the Lord told me on the very first Sunday to announce to the congregation that we would be debt-free in 100 days and we would sell no chicken. That's what he told me. The next week he said, we will be debt-free in order to owe no man but to love him. Now, the signs weren't there. When I took over the church, we had less than 1,000 in the bank account. And so if I looked at what was there, I would become discouraged. But I knew that I heard the word of God, the voice of God. I knew that God spoke to me. And I understood that obedience became my responsibility and outcomes are God's. So I want to say to the local pastors there that obedience is our responsibility. To the local leaders, obedience is our responsibility. We have to take God at his word and not look for the results or the signs, because outcomes belong to the Lord. So we set the 100-day challenge, and the Friday before it was time to burn the mortgage, the presbyter would come down and we would burn a copy of the mortgage and sing hallelujah and thank you, Jesus. We were $7,500 short. A couple came into the office around 12 o'clock and they said, Pastor, we just got an inheritance for $75,000. Here's a check for $7,500. Use it however you will. I had one question for them. My question was, will the check bounce? They said, no, Pastor, it's good. So we went and we paid off the mortgage, got two copies, the original, and made some copies. And that Sunday, we burnt the mortgage. From that day to now, the ministry here gives thousands and thousands of dollars a year to missions because we listen to the voice of God. I want to say to you, local pastor, it doesn't matter how difficult it is. It doesn't matter what neighborhood and environment you find yourself in. It doesn't matter what the world challenges are. I mean, gas here in Key West is now a whopping $4.50 in the U.S. And I know it's probably close to $6 there at home. It doesn't matter your circumstances. And not only the cattle on the thousand hill belongs to God, but the hills also. And so I want to encourage you to respond to his voice. Be that leader that your belief system is based on what God says. Let's move on. Verse 10. Verse 10 is a powerful scripture. Verse 10 simply says, you do not believe that I am in the Father and the Father in me. The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the work. I want to speak about power and authority. Power is something that we take, something that we buy, something that we steal. Authority is something that is given to us. Jesus said he received the authority from the Father. And later on in the scripture, he passes that authority unto us. We are Christ's ambassadors on the earth. So we're not functioning in power. We're functioning in authority. And a part of that authority is seen in the dunamis, or the power of the Holy Spirit that is able to change, that is able to transform, that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above that which we can ask or think according to the power that is inside of us. And so we must look at authority. We are being granted authority. Jesus said he saw the devil as lightning falling from heaven. So the church has been granted the authority to do what? To go into all the world and to make disciples. I want you to turn with me in your Bibles to Mark's Gospel, chapter 16. And I want to address something that might not sit well with everyone on this Zoom conference tonight. As Pentecostals, I believe and I feel as Pentecostals that we have placed the foundation as the ultimate. When we talk about greater works, what were the works that Jesus did? He healed the sick. He raised the dead. He delivered those who were demon-possessed. As Pentecostals, we believe that speaking in tongues and healing the sick and raising the dead and deliverance is the ultimate of what we can be. When Christ says, it's the foundation. And so we need to understand that we can never be stronger than our foundation, but what we are stuck on is the foundation. Greater works are what we build on that foundation. And so Jesus gives an example, and the Lord says in Mark 16, verse 15, take a look at this. This is so powerful, and I won't be much longer, but just take a look at this. He said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Number one, we believe that salvation is what we ought to go and do. And it's not so. Salvation is only a part of the Great Commission. It is only an element of the Great Commission. The purpose of the Great Commission is to make disciples in all nations. Salvation is a given. You cannot become a disciple without a true salvation experience. We repent of our sins, we turn from it. But that's not where the greater works are. The greater works is how do we take a person through the power of the Holy Spirit, through the word of God, and see them become a disciple maker. And so here's what he says. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes, not he who preaches. Oh, Lord, have mercy. I want somebody to get this in their spirit. He who believes and is baptized will be saved. But he who does not believe will be condemned. So there's a heaven to gain and a hell to shun. That's part of our preaching of the message. But let's go on. Let's go on. But he who, and these signs will follow those who believe. You see, Jesus came, and one of the titles that we give to Jesus is that we refer to him as the second Adam. As the second Adam, he came to restore what we lost in the first Adam. The first Adam had dominion authority. He was not created perfect. He was created innocent. And he failed in that. He failed in that, and therefore he was put out of the garden. Sin came in, and now Jesus comes as the second Adam to restore what we had originally. And what did we have? Dominion authority. So look what happens to those who believe the preaching of the gospel. Number one, in my name, they will cast out demons. Cast out demons, why? Because we have dominion authority. Second, they will speak with new tongues, dominion authority. Third, what will they do? They will take up serpents. Now, I find this interesting. When I think of taking up serpents, I go back to, in my mind, to Moses, when Moses had a rod. Moses trusted in that rod. Moses was a shepherd. Moses was in the backside of the wilderness and he used that rod that represent his craft and the skill set that came from his abilities. And the Lord said to Moses, I want you to throw the rod down on the ground. When he threw the rod down on the ground, it changed into a serpent. And the Lord said, I want you to take it up. Part of discipleship is allowing people to get to the place that they take what they trust in, they take what they have developed a skill set in, they take what they believe empowers them and provides for them, and they give it to God, and they let God change it, and they're not afraid to pick it up again. That's part of the greater works. Helping individuals that if any man comes after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross and follow me daily. Teaching individuals to take what they are trusted in and let God empower it. And it might look different. It might seem strange, but have enough faith to pick it up because your gift will make room for you and bring you before great men. And then he goes on and he says, if they drink any deadly thing, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. The scripture says that these signs follow them that believe. Once we believe, these signs are there, which means that these occurrences are the foundation of our lives. We're empowered by the Holy Spirit so that we can be a witness in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the outermost parts of the world. The baptism of the Holy Spirit is just an entrance into that dimension so that we can find our place in God. God has an assignment for every one of us. The same way when he said to Noah, Noah, I want you to build the ark. And he said, here's how you're going to build it. The ark was built in such a way that it had the temple to fulfill the assignment. God has fashioned you with the uniqueness of who you are. As he said to Jeremiah, when you're in your mother's womb, I formed you. I have a plan for you, a plan not to harm you, but to help you into and to bring a future into your life. God has an assignment for you and the uniqueness of how he has crafted you and the seasons that you have gone through is to help you to fulfill that assignment. In August the 18th through September the 7th, I had the honor of serving in Lakai, Haiti. And I served there for 21 days, living in a tent, working with Samaritans First International. And we had put up a field hospital. And in 21 days, we had ministered to 33,100 trauma patients. I remember one day, the Haitian army brought a gentleman onto the campus and he had 6 gunshot wounds. He had 2 to the chest, 2 to the left leg and 2 to the right. And the doctor came to me and he said, chaplain, 1 or 2 things are going to happen to this man. He's either going to bleed out on this cart or he's going to lose his left leg because the artery has burst and we can't find a pulse. And so he's going to lose his left leg. Through a translator, I was able to kneel by this man's bed and the blood was just gushing out. The blood was so hot that when it hit me, it would cave. And we led him to the Lord and he started to cry out in the name of Jesus. He started to cry out in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. And in 3 minutes, the doctors started to shout and to scream. And he said, there is a pulse. God not only saved this man's soul, but he also saved his name. But I want you to listen to me just for a moment. As fantastic as that seems, that is only the foundational work. Because when that man was released from the hospital, because of the earthquake, he had no home to go to. The greater works that we are talking about is able to help individuals to come to a place of self-sustainability in God. A place where the scripture says, let a man work that he may have to give to others in need. A place where we stop giving from our need and we begin to give from our abundance. Greater work. I can share with you story after story, but God wants to raise up men and women throughout the world that can give out of their abundance and don't need to sow a seed and ask God for a blessing upon their lives, but individuals that can help others arrive to a place where their gift is making room for them and that they are being used of God to transform communities and families and even nations. Let me look to a final verse of scripture as we talk about Jesus. So he came to the earth, or to get this down in your spirit, he came to the earth as Savior. And then what we have a tendency to go over is, check this out in verse 12. Back to John chapter 14 and verse 12. He said, most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these he will do. Why? Why? Because he takes up another assignment. He will do greater works. Why? Because I go back to my Father. What assignment does he take up? He's sitting on the right hand of the Father as the intercessor for us. Because here's what the scripture says. And whatsoever you ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Friend, we can do the greater works of God, not only because God spoke it, not only because the Holy Spirit resides inside of us, not only because we are committed to it, but we have an opportunity to do the greater works of nation transformation, family and community transformation, the greater work of discipleship, the greater works of empowerment. Why? Because Jesus has taken up a new assignment. He's sitting on the right-hand side of the Father, making intercession for us. I want to encourage you to understand that your purpose on this earth is to fulfill God's purpose for your life. I share something that I've only shared with three or four people. We have a ministry in Nassau that is going to become a hope center. When I was 11 years old, oh Lord, 52 years ago, I had a speech impediment. My Androsian grandmother said, if you are left-handed, you owe the devil a day's work, and they put a bag on my hand and sent me to school. In St. Thomas More in Nassau at 11 years old, I failed the entrance exam to St. Augustine's. All my first, I had to repeat. The next year, in the first class, Miss Kinnear, the teacher, took me to Sister Mary Lou. I couldn't understand the first day of class. I didn't throw any spitballs. I couldn't understand what I did wrong. She took me to Sister Mary Lou, and she said, Jonathan is my choice. Wow. So Sister Mary Lou said, every Friday you come here, we're going to give you the deposit bag, and you're going to walk across the street to Barclays Bank, and you're going to make a deposit because we believe in you. Friend, part of the MO in my life from the time I got saved was to work with troubled kids and simply say to them, I believe. God has given to each one of us an assignment. And if you fulfill that assignment, you are doing greater works. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the superintendent, the assistant superintendent, the missions directors. I thank you for the presbyter. I thank you for the leadership of the Assemblies of God in the Bahamas and the Turks and Caicos. Father, I thank you for this season of opportunity. I thank you that you have called the Bahamas and the Turks and Caicos to not only be a receiving nation, but a sending and a going nation. And that, Father, your Son sits on your right hand, making intercession for us, so that as we individually and collectively fulfill our purpose, we're doing the greater works. I pray that there will be no financial need within that district, that you would bless them. I pray that you would enlarge their territory. I pray for each pastor. I pray for each pastor that you would speak encouragement into their hearts and lives. And as dim and as dismal as things seem, may they walk according to your voice, not according to what they see. I pray, Father, that you would bless everyone on this conference call tonight. I pray for the anointing of your Spirit that breaks the yoke of bondage. I pray, Father, that we would not only have influence in the mountains of culture, but rather we will be the influencers, we'll be the leaders within the mountains of culture. May we understand that we are salt and Father, we are light. May we walk in the greater works so that men may see our good works and glorify you, which is in heaven. And so we thank you. We thank you for the opportunity to celebrate the diversity of gifts. We thank you for the opportunity to work together, and that the head or the knee can't say to the elbow, I have no need of you. We thank you for the commission and the empowerment of the Church of Jesus Christ. So bless tonight, we pray. Multiply the finances. Oh God, multiply. Send into that district men and women that will give and are able to give from their abundance. I thank you now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Wow, to God be the glory. Thank you so much, Pastor Carey. What a moving, stirring word to close this awesome conference out tonight. Why don't we do the work of the Lord? Do greater works, make disciples, become fishers of men. Do the assignment that God has given you. We can't let any of these great words of encouragement fall to the ground tonight. Everyone that has an ear to hear, I pray that you've heard what the Spirit of the Lord is saying, that you be a part of giving to cause greater things to be manifested in the earth, in the Grand Bahama District, to be an influencer. You can do this. I want to encourage you right now, if you've not signed the pledge form yet, we're going to show it again online in the Zoom platform as well as in Facebook. You can fill out online right now and make that commitment to give to your church so that your church can give to missions and so that we can all be a part of creating and manifesting the greater works that Jesus has called us to do. Aren't you excited about the opportunity that has awakened all of us to do greater works tonight? So I want to encourage you, please make that move tonight. And when you go to church on Sunday, ask your pastor to give you the form. I also want you to influence others in your church. Not everyone was online tonight. We had a great audience. Thank you all for being here. But there are many from your church that was not online tonight. Make them aware of the mission and the faith promise and encourage them to be a part of committing to ministry, to mission. And we'll all be a part of doing God's work. Aren't you excited? I am excited. I can't stop saying that word because I am truly excited about the great works. I'm excited about everything I heard tonight from the great men and women of God here tonight. Please sow into the Grand Bahama District, sow into your church so that we can do missions. Right now, we're going to call Reverend Dr. Eunice Jones, and she's going to pray for the mission faith pledges tonight. So you want to be blessed. We're going to call Reverend Jones. Will you come now? Please turn on your camera, Reverend Jones. We'd like to see you and okay. Turn on your mic.
Good night, everyone. Amen. Let us pray. The Heavenly Father, God, we give you thanks. We give you praise. We exalt and magnify your holy name. Father, as we come to you tonight, Father, we thank you for all that has been said. We pray now, Father, that the same traits that you have, we have, that we must demonstrate these traits by using our compassion. So that in using our compassion, Father, realizing that there are lost souls, there are persons living in darkness, bound, bruised, broken. So, Father God, we pray right now that we will demonstrate your love by giving, not only giving financially, but by giving, God, in prayer, by giving, by going, giving, Father God, by encouraging. And so, Father, we pray, God, that you would raise up intercessors who will pray for those who will go, because we know the work is hard sometimes, Father, and there are lack. We pray that the church of God, who you have ordained to be a part of mission, because you said in your word that we ought to go into all the world and preach the gospel, amen, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son. So, Father, we pray that we will be disciples first before we can make disciples. And so, Father, we pray right now, God, that you will release a fresh anointing upon us, that we will demonstrate your love in our giving, and that we will go throughout all the world supporting our missionaries, praying for them, encouraging them, and lifting them up. We pray for the body of Christ, that, Father God, that the things that we did not do concerning mission, forgive us, cleanse us, wash us. But from this night forward, we pray that you, God, will have mercy on us. And as you begin to release your anointing afresh upon us, that we will have a new mindset in giving, that we will have a new perspective in giving, that we will give generously to mission, yes, realizing, God, that someone is in need of a savior. Someone is in need of healing. Someone is in need of deliverance. Because we realize that when we give, God, we reset people, we refresh people, we revive people, we restore people in giving. And so, Father, we know that it's an imperative that we give. So right now, Father, we pray a fresh anointing upon every person listening to us tonight, that, Father, that they will be able to open up their arms and give generously to your work. Because in giving, you bless us. And as we give, Father, even as your word declares, it is better to give than to receive. And so we pray right now, Father, that there will be a releasing of giving in the assemblies of God like never before. Yes. And so, Father, right now, God, send your holy anointing right now, Father, that we will give like we have never given before, so that the world can be set free, that those who are blind will see again, that those who are lost will be found again. Father, right now, God, we pray for every missionary. We pray for our national missionary, God. We pray for our district missionary. We pray for our evangelists and all of those who are part of giving and all of those who are part of going. Father, right now, we pray, God, Lord of the harvest, that you will send laborers, faithful laborers who will go into the vineyard and do what you have called us to do. Father, right now, we pray a special blessing upon all of those who went. And so we pray, God, that every need will be met according to your riches and glory through us, the church. And Father, cause us not to sleep until we realize how important it is in giving. It's life and death for some. And so, Father, right now, God, we give you thanks and praise, and we believe by faith from henceforth we will give to your work, to your mission, to your will. And so, Father, right now, touch us in a special way and bless us as you bless us, so we could be a blessing to others, because you called us to be our brother's keeper. And we can only do this when our hearts have compassion and love, and we demonstrate the love that you have called us to demonstrate, because we are an agency of love. So, Father, right now, we give you thanks and praise, because we believe and we declare by faith that we will give generously from now on. So to God be the glory. We believe henceforth great things he will do in us and through us as we give, as we go, as we pray, as we encourage. Bless us now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Praise God. We thank God for sealing everything that was said and done here tonight, and for your giving to be blessed in Jesus' name. You know, the greatest miracle that Jesus wants is that which can happen every day. When a rebellious sinner can come to Jesus, his sins forgiven, and God lavishes grace on him, adopts him as a child of the kingdom, and seals him for eternity. And so let's continue to reach out, share the gospel with everyone, and see God do great and mighty things in their lives. Tonight, as we bless you, we want you to stay online and watch us in this great video as we close. We will close with this great video. So hang on. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. In Jesus' name, God bless you. Thank you for joining us.
You're the God of this city, you're the King of these people, You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. For greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. You're the God of this city. You're the King of this people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like I. Greater things have yet to come, and greater.